Hello, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Lux Winkels and welcome back to lesson 9 on how to compose classical music for dummies. And today is all about dynamics and articulation. But not before we will reveal last week's topic, we will revisit it. And last week's was all about Roman numeral analysis, which was probably a bit of a more difficult video, but in lesson 10 we will get back to it. But it is important to know that in a major key, the diatonic triads are 1, 4, and 5 always major, 2, 3, and 6 always minor, and the 7th is always diminished. And in lesson 10 again, we will go over chord functions and more about how Roman numeral analysis works. But today is just a bit of a chill lesson about articulations and dynamics. So first, dynamics. When we are in an orchestra, in a band, or in a chamber orchestra, or when you just play some music with friends, there are always some musicians that play the main melody, the most important melody. Others are playing just the second or third melody, others just chords, and others just the bass line. And it is important that the main voice always kind of stands out. You do not want to go to a rock concert where the bass guitar is incredibly much louder than the lead guitar. That's just a bit weird. And to tell musicians the dynamics in classical music, we use some Italian. And in this chart is what you need to remember. We have a lot of P's, M's, and F's. So P means piano, and it means playing soft, really quietly. F means forte, which is loud. To make it even more piano, we put another P in front. Pianissimo means not soft, but very soft. And if you would have three P's, pianissimo, that would mean very, very soft. And that's the same with forte. F is loud, double F is very loud. To get in between, to get a medium sound, we use the M from mezzo. Mezzo piano, medium soft, mezzo forte, medium loud. And the way I'm talking right now probably is mezzo forte. To get a more smooth transition between dynamics, we use crescendos and decrescendo, where crescendo means we start soft and get gradually louder, and decrescendo means the opposite, gradually softer. So in this example down below, we start on a G as soft piano, and we gradually getting louder until the D will be on forte. We also have articulations, which is how to play notes. And also in this chart, I have the four most important ones and the fifth one written here below. First, staccato, which means there is a dot above or under the note. That means we have to, the note will be really quick. And we also have dotted notes, which you should not confuse that with. We also have notes on the side, which means the length of the note gets 50% more, but now the dot is above the dot or below. That's important to know the difference. We also have staccato. We also have an accent, where we accent the note, which is a kind of a arrow symbol above or below. Tenuto, when we hold the note for its full length. And fermata, when we hold the note as long as we want or as the conductor slash composer wants. We also have legato, a bended line that means we play the notes smooth together. So staccato will be bom, 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 bom. Accent would be bom, 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 bom. Tenuto would be ba, 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 bom, which are long notes, but still individually, whereas legato is kind of tenuto, but all the notes are together. Ba, da, 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 da. The notes are smoothly blend in after each other. So this is a lot of theory and a lot of concepts, and the best way to explain it would be to go over to MuseScore and to just listen to three examples. So the first example I would like to hear you to let you hear is a tango, and this is without any articulations or dynamics. So let's first listen how it would sound without any of this. You can hear that all the notes sound a bit the same. It is, yes, it sounds good or anything, but it just feels so dead. I'm not able to listen to this because all the notes are together. There is no excitement, and I will let you hear it with the articulations. We can already see a lot of staccato accents. We can see a legato. Is there somewhere tenuto? I think, yeah, here we see tenuto. So, and I hope you can hear the difference. So instead of ba da 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 da, right now you hear pa 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 dum pa da da pa 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 dum, and it gets way more. There is so much more excitement. The piece is not dead anymore. It is just way more pleasant to listen to. That accent. So, as the composer or the arranger, you can not only write the notes, but you can also let the musicians know how to play it. You can show where the articulations are, because there is a difference between just playing the notes and making actual music. So it is really important to know that there are articulations to make the music more exciting. The second example is a bit less obvious maybe, but I still wanted to let you hear this. And this is a bit jazzy, and I will first let you hear it again without any articulations or dynamics. Here down below you can see the Roman numeral analysis, but just don't look at them too much. Right now you can hear it with the articulations and dynamics. You can already see accents, staccatos, legatos. The difference is a bit, it is not a too obvious difference, but there are the small things in art, just the small little details that make a piece stand out, that makes your artwork, no matter if it's music or if it is a painting or whatever you are doing, the small accents you add really add up to the end result. And as a composer, you can show this. And I would like to hear you one last thing, which is more on dynamics, because we can also use dynamics to create a contrast. When we have a piece that has two different kind of themes, it will be It is often a good idea, in my opinion, to get a contrast between. And in my composition New Life, I go from all instruments really loud to just one instrument in piano. And I want to hear to you the effect that you can create by adding more layers and by contrasting the dynamics. It starts with, say, crescendo to forte and fortissimo. Second and third violins in pianissimo. Gradually louder, and you can create with dynamics a magical feeling. As a composer, it is important to have a palette of things you can work with, and sometimes just using the basic dynamics just add so much stuff. I mean, I can delete this to just see how terrible it sounds without dynamics. Let's hear. Yeah, without the dynamics, it sounds like it is all together. Whereas with articulation, you can hear that these first four measures are together, and that the fifth measure is part of a new theme on something that develops. You can hear the difference. And so with articulation and dynamics is something as a composer where we can share with the musicians how to actually play our music. And in lesson 19, I think, yeah, probably lesson 19, we are going to start composing ourselves, and then I will go back and tell again about articulations and dynamics. So, let's do a test. I have an example here. In which key is this piece? And I hope you already know the Circle of Fifths, but if not, here it is. So, we see two sharps, which means 1-2 D major, or 1-2-3 B minor, right? So, we look at the last measure. What notes do we see? You can pause the video if you want, by the way. Well, we see a B, a D, a D, F sharp, B, F sharp, F sharp, B. So we see a lot of B, F sharp, and D. So, well, both D major and B minor are still possible. When both are still possible, that means we have a minor chord. And if you do not believe me, you should, but we can also test it, because D major will be D, E, F sharp, G, A. D, F sharp, A, we don't have an A. And B minor will be B, C, D, E, F sharp, B, D, F sharp. So if both are still possible, because it is either D major or B minor, we see both B and D, that means we have a minor chord. So this is in B minor. Second question. In which measure is the choir the loudest? Since it's a piece for soprano, tenor, alto, and bass. Which measure? We see a lot of Bs, Fs, MP, MF, FFP. What was the loudest? The correct answer will be the beginning of measure 6, because FF means fortissimo. That's not loud, but very loud. So that is louder as a single F, and the Bs all means really quietly, and MF means just medium loud. So beginning of measure 6, the choir is the loudest. What does this circled symbol mean? Well, we have talked about. It is a decrescendo. And what does this? Well, we start on forte and we gradually get less loud until the next measure all the voices are in mezzo piano, which is medium soft. So start loud and slowly becoming softer. So let's do a knowledge check on some stuff. In an orchestra, there are many different instruments played at the same time, but the most important instrumental instruments most of the time play louder than the less instruments. The example I told you where you do not want to hear a rock band where the bass guitar is way louder than the lead guitar. You want to hear the melody. So, what is the most important instrument? In this case, what instrument is playing the loudest? Well, let's see, we see a lot of MP, F, MF, MF, MP, 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 MP. So what of this is the loudest? Well, the loudest is F, forte. And in this piece, the oboe is the most important instrument. Although in this section, it has the main melody, and therefore, as the composer, I do not want you to guess what the main melody is. I want you to sit back, relax, listen to my music. It needs to be obvious. That's why I almost always, if not always, have the main melody the loudest. In this case, is that oboe on forte. How is the note called with a circle? Because a couple of lessons back I taught about the ledger lines. So what is this note? And here I have it bigger in case you are on a really small screen. So you can pause the video if you want to. So what is the first thing we always look for? Well, we are in G clef and we see a crap ton amount of flats. First, let's just see what this note is, alright? So, this is the second line is G, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, A, B. It is a B, it is B, B flat, because we have a B flat. This note is called a B flat. And how many beats are there in one bar / measure? Because that is also something we have covered so far. I'm just checking if you guys know everything I've talked about in all the previous lessons. Well, what was the thing we looked for? We look at time signature. We are in 4-4, which means every measure has 4 beats and the quarter note is 1 beat. So 4. And the last question. What chord is played in the first measured in by the second violins? You can use the circle of fifths. So we have again a crap ton amount of flats. We have a B flat, E flat, A flat, D flat, G flat and C flat. And we are in E flat. E flat, G, E flat, G flat, B flat. So is this E flat major, E flat minor or E flat diminished? Well, first let's check if it is E flat major. Always check major first. So E flat has 1, 2, 3 flats, which is B flat, E flat, A flat. So E major 1, 3, 5 would mean E, F, G, A, B, E flat, G, B flat. Yeah. And we have E flat, G flat, B flat. So the first and fifth notes are correct, but the third note is flattened. 1, flat, 3, 5 means this chord, E flat, G flat, B flat, is minor. Because it is E flat major, but the G has become a G flat. So this was really chill short lesson where I just talked about dynamics and articulation. It may seem incredibly easy, but it is so important to remember, because with these things you can really elevate your music. And when we are going to start composing in lesson 19, I will talk a lot more about dynamics and articulations, but I wanted to properly introduce it. Next lesson will be a slightly more difficult lesson again. We're going to talk about chord functions, popular progressions, how we can relate this to our Roman numeral analysis. So if you have any questions, as always, just compose a comment, let me know, and I will answer it in detail. For now, this was just a really short lesson on how to compose classical music for dummies, and I will hopefully see you in the next lesson.